God's grace and peace to you, my friends. As we continue thinking about how fear and being afraid has a factor in all we do in our life, I hope you've had a chance to reflect upon what we talked about last week, that you have come with your hearts opened, your mind clear, that we might explore this topic together and find new ways through our faith and through our relationship with the living Christ to begin to explore more abundant life, more joyful living, and all the ways that God's love moves through us in this world. Let us begin our worship and know that in this worship that God is present with us, whether we be sitting next to one another or on the other side of the world, that the love of God that encircles and unfolds each of us is ever present, scattered, gathered, far, near, and wide, because God's love is never ending. Let us worship together.
Breath of life and full.
you join me in our call to worship? Living rock of abundant life, the poor cried out. You heard and saved them from all their troubles.
To those who have nothing, your promise is this: whatever is needed will be given.
Your eyes are on those who do justice, and your ears are open to their voice.
All those who yearn for peace, your promise is this: whatever is needed will be given.
Your arms enfold the brokenhearted and rescue those whose spirits are crushed.
To those who fear the future, your promise is this: whatever is needed will be given. Oh, taste and see how good God is. Happy are those who take refuge in the living rock.
Let us pray together. Oh, Holy One, we are blessed to be in your presence. We know that no matter what happens in this world, nothing can separate us from your love. We give thanks for the abundant blessings in our lives and the unending grace that enfolds us. Amen.
A reading from the sixth book of Judges. Now the angel of the Lord came to Gideon and said to him, "The Lord is with you, you mighty warrior." Gideon answered him, "But sir, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our ancestors recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has cast us off and given us into the hand of Midian, the worshippers of Baal." Then the Lord turned to him and said, "Go in this might of yours and deliver Israel from the hand of Midian." He responded, "But sir, how can I deliver Israel? My clan is the weakest, and I am the least in my family." The Lord said to him, "But I will be with you." That night the Lord said to him, "Go and pull down the altar of Baal that belongs to your father, and cut down the sacred pole that is beside it, and build an altar to the Lord your God on the top of the stronghold there." Gideon took his servants and did as the Lord had told him, but because he was too afraid of his family and the townspeople to do it by day, he did it by night. When the townspeople rose early in the morning, the altar of Baal was broken down, and the sacred pole beside it was cut down. They said to one another, "Who has done this?" After searching and inquiring, they were told, "Gideon, son of Joash, did it." Then the townspeople said to Joash, "Bring out your son, so that he may die, for he has pulled down the altar of Baal and cut down the sacred pole beside it." But Joash said, "If Baal is a god, let him contend for himself." Then all the Midianites and their allies came together, and crossing the Jordan, they encamped in the valley. But the Spirit of the Lord took possession of Gideon, and he sounded the trumpet, and his people were called out to follow him. After a great battle, Midian was subdued before the Israelites, and they lifted up their heads no more. So the land had rest for 40 years in the days of Gideon.
Gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me.
So far, we've talked about understanding our fear and naming our fear. So today, I want to talk a little bit about educating ourselves about our fear. In his inaugural address, FDR Franklin Delano Roosevelt said, "I am certain my fellow Americans expect that on my induction into the presidency, I will address them with candor and a decision which the present situation of our people impel. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth, the whole truth, frankly and boldly. Nor need we shrink from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, and will revive and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance." You probably recognize the situation that he was speaking in. And sometimes it doesn't feel too much off from what we're facing today. But his assertion, time and time again, the only thing we have to fear is fear of itself. The reality is we are afraid of nothing so much as the unknown. We as people do not like change, which is the constant. We like to know what's going to happen. We want to know. How many of you are schedule makers, list makers, like to know day to day? You know, it's a certain day of the week and you're wearing a certain shirt. Some people will joke with me about my uniform that I wear when I'm not on a Sunday, which up until this pandemic would have been the exact same blue shirt. I own 9 of them. Don't have to think about it. It's just consistency. It's nice to just have that there and not have to worry about it. I sadly, or maybe importantly, eat the same breakfast most days. It's just easier that way. It doesn't require thinking. I don't have to worry. I can just go. And that unknown is what sets us off that path, that causes us to question, and for many of us, makes us very nervous and fills us with fear. So let's talk about Gideon. Probably not a character you've spent a lot of time with. You might remember Gideon's name being thrown out among some songs, some old spirituals that talk about Gideon in the stories of Joshua and others like this. But in general, you don't hear a whole lot about Gideon. It comes in a very, well, bloody passage of time in the Hebrew Bible. But here's Gideon. Gideon is faced with all sorts of terror at the hands of the Midianites, this conquering people who had taken over and forced all the Israelites into service, among other things. And his biggest fear was not the Midianites, but that he or his people or the combination of the two would be inadequate to do the task at hand. He did the same excuses Moses did. He said, "I'm not the one you want. You got to find someone better. I'm the least of my family and of my clan. Pick someone better than me." And if you remember what God told Moses, said the same to Gideon, "I will be with you. What more do you need?" Now let's recognize that doesn't solve things. Knowing that God is with you is not always going to be the thing that says, "Now I can do this. Okay, I don't know what I was so worried about." So let's take some steps to think about how Gideon responded and how we might use the same. So step one, think before you act. I mean, this seems like a no-brainer, right? Gideon needed to think about what he was going to do, to make a plan, to not act rashly. In fact, he tore down the statue of Baal and the altar with help at night so that he wouldn't be facing the village and his own family. It made sense to learn what he needed to do before he did it, so he knew what to expect. Step two, know the facts. So God has called Gideon, said, "Here's what you need to do." And instead of listening to what his friends said, because as much as we love our friends, sometimes our friends are not the best sources for good information for our lives. He avoided rumor. He avoided speculation. He kept it in proportion. So he made a plan then, based on this good information that he had, to lead his people to defeat the Midianites. This was no small task. This was a terrifying thing that he was being called to do for someone who felt he was inadequate to the task. So he just rounded up the posse and attacked, right? He made his plan. He learned what he needed to do and who he needed to talk to, and then he acted. And maybe the most important of the three I'll offer you today. Sometimes the fear of what's going to happen is worse than what's actually going on. In Gideon's case, he had a choice. He could stand up for himself and his people, or he could continue to be occupied and dominated by the Midianites. So he rose up and he fought for their freedom. He rallied his folks to do what was right. And it was terrifying. And it was hard. And it was awful. But the alternative was so much worse. But until you start to think through that process, that fear alone is enough to paralyze us in the tracks. So I know what I'm saying is not simple. As someone who loves books, if you hadn't learned this about me, someone who likes learning, sometimes to the point of paralysis, I find it easy to stay in that learning phase and just avoid the acting phase. I could tell you all about it. Have I done it? No. But I've read a book about it. It's not going to be the thing that moves you forward. Education is essential, but it is not the end result. It's a part of the process. So what are you afraid of? What fears are holding you hostage? What can you learn about whatever that is that can make you think more clearly about what's at hand? Think before you act. Know your facts, avoid the rumor, the speculation, keep things in proportion. And sometimes the reality is bad, but you might find that the fear is so much worse than whatever you are afraid of happening. So, you need to keep yourself armed with knowledge so that you can face your deepest fears, to know about them intimately once you've been able to claim it. And you might be surprised at what you can learn. You might be surprised at what you find out. And maybe that fear isn't so bad after all, because you've learned a little trick along the way. Maybe you'll be able to open up about what you're afraid of when you know more about it. Maybe this will be the step you need to take to move yourself from inaction into action. So with that in mind, may you know that God will be with you in your success and failure. May you know that no matter what, God will be with you as God was with Gideon. Amen. My friends, I invite you to join me into a time of prayer. In the book of Hebrews we read, "For he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid." God, we come to you with our hearts overwhelmed, our hearts full, questioning all of the things that we do not understand in this world, and at the same time giving thanks for all the blessings that surround us. We'd ask that you would continue to fill us with your Spirit, that we would be given strength and courage for the facing of each day, that we would have the ability and the will as your people to go out into this world and care for those who are struggling most. We would ask for healing for those who are struggling, for peace for those who cannot find rest, for strength and courage for those facing adversity, and in all things, your love, grace, and mercy to surround us, to fill us, to pull us and push us and call us into being more fully the people you have created us to be. We ask for these blessings not for our own sake, but for the sake of all of your children in this world who struggle, for all of your children in this world who need a boost, a reminder of the goodness of God, a reminder of the taste of the goodness that is in your creation. Remind us, God, of your deep and abiding love for each of us. Remind us that we might pour out that love on a world in need. We give great thanks for all of the gifts that you have given us, all the opportunities and challenges that have faced in our lives. We would ask that you stay with us, that you hold us close, that you remind us that we are your children, holy and beloved. And it is because we know of your great love and the great gift you offer to us in Jesus that we raise our voices together and pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us pray together. God, we would ask you to bless the gifts that we offer up. We would ask to bless our lives that we may be of continued service in this world. We ask that you would give us strength and courage to continue to be blessings for all of your creation, both near and far. For all of the good gifts that you have poured out upon us and continue to do in our daily lives, God. We give you thanks in the name of the one who calls us into new life. Amen. Now go, my friends. Go out into the world in need. Be the hands and feet of the living Christ. Go and take care of all that God has called us to, so that when we meet again, we can say in bold proclamation that we have poured out the love of God upon our brothers and sisters who are struggling, that we have poured out the love of God into a world in need. Go and care for all of those, including yourself, who need a reminder of the great goodness of God's love. Go in peace and serve the Lord.